Morocco.
I'm Devin Albrecht.
And I'm Justin Niver.
And we are the 2017-2018 BUV team for Alfred State. And we are sponsored by the Institute for Affordable Transportation, which provides affordable vehicles for impoverished countries. Here is our BUV 3D model. This was created using Autodesk Inventor Professional 2018. This is just a general, obviously, 3D overview of what we have. We'll get into later on showing you the actual vehicle. Here's our presentation outline. We're going to show you some design improvements, our competition data, our competition results, future improvement recommendations, and then later we're going to take you on an actual video tour of the BUV and then show you some footage from our competition. Now, to start off with the improvement outline, as you'll see, some of these improvements are very familiar. We have to improve our steering geometry, we have to outfit our new water pump, and we have to install a new engine. Now, some of these improvements came up as we were working on the BUV itself. We didn't realize some of the issues that were, you know, kind of hidden. You know, we pull apart a layer and it's like an onion, you just find more and more. So we had to fabricate some new PTO and pump shafts. We had to improve the powertrain accessibility. When it came to removing the engine, we weren't able to remove it without cutting off the frame. We have to improve our low gear actuation cable, helps our transmission out a little bit, install a new floorboard, and we wanted to maximize our power output so that we could perform the best at competition.
So a little bit about the steering geometry. As you saw before in the previous presentation, we wanted to move our axle center behind the center line of the steering so it tracked better in the mud. It both aids in the tracking while it moved forward, and the wheel naturally rights itself back to the center position while you're moving forward. Along with those benefits, it also provides a shorter wheelbase and improves the turning radius. It also increases the front end clearance to clear higher obstacles that you may encounter at competition. And it also improves the suspension by placing more of the load on the trailing arm spring, and it made it so it was a softer ride. So here is the layout for the design of the front end. As you can see, the old design here is just the lines and it's not the shaded model. You can see that the original axle position was in front of the center line of the steering. And this caused it to want to basically reverse itself, and it made it basically uncontrollable in the mud. And with our new design, the shaded model here, you can see the new axle position is moved behind the center line of the steering, making it so that it rights itself and it's easier to track in the mud. Here's some of the pictures during the fabrication. We ended up using Dicam die to mark out the section that we were cutting, and we marked out the lines where we wanted to cut. Here's a picture of it after it was cut with a cutoff wheel, and in the following slides, you'll see where we tacked it all together to make sure that the fit was right, and we verified that the angle was correct. And then after this, it was all welded together and ground and polished for paint.
One of our other things that we did was install a new water pump. And this pump was a Northern Tool semi-trash water pump, model WP20. It improved the theoretical flow rate for our system from 60 GPM from the previous pump to 131 GPM. We machined the new water pump drive shaft to accommodate the impeller, and this was machined within 0.5 concentricity. Along with this, we mounted the pump housing perpendicular to the output shaft, and the previous design was not running true. So when the pump was in motion, it was kind of grinding, and it caused some wear on the impeller inside the pump. So when we took the old pump apart, we saw that that was inside, and that would have caused a problem for this year. And we think that some of the debris from the pond also wore on the pump, so that's why we got a trash pump for this year's competition. We also added bushings to prevent the pump shaft from moving back and forth, so it was just locked in place. And we made new pipe fittings to adapt the existing pump, which was 1.5 NPT, to the new system, which was 2 NPT, or 2 inches NPT, which helped create a bigger or larger flow and helped out with decrease the pumping process. This is a model and some of the specs for our new pump. As you can see, the port size is 2 inches, and some of the other things that it covers was the required horsepower to run it is 4. A bore circle size of 3 5/8 inches, and it's sealed silicone carbide, and the impeller is made out of cast iron. Our new engine was a Yanmar L100W model diesel engine. It was single cylinder, 4-cycle, air cooled, and it was rated for 9.3 horsepower. The engine speed was 3,600 RPM, and the maximum output was 18 pound feet at 2,000 RPM. Our fuel consumption was 0.61 gallons per hour, and our output shaft diameter was 1 inch. This is a picture of our new engine that we got in, and we ran into some trouble when we went to go install it, but we will talk about them here shortly.
So for the PTO and pump shafts, they both had to be redesigned. The old PTO shaft was very poorly set up. It had 15 washers in order to accommodate for a larger bolt, because it has to basically be sandwiched between the centrifugal clutch and where the mounting bolt is in order to hold the shim in place to drive the water pump. So we machined a new shaft, and it was lengthened out to avoid using all of those washers. And this was a 1-inch diameter shaft with a 1/4-inch key to fit inside the bore of the clutch. The pump shaft, the existing shaft, wouldn't mesh with the previous, or with a new pump. The previous one, the impeller was threaded on, whereas this impeller was actually keyed and it was held on with a bolt. And we also made it to fit with a new pump and machined it down to tolerances that were required in order to work with the existing gear drive. So here's a picture of the new PTO shaft. After it was finished, we pressed the pulley on and got the key all fitted. This is the section here that goes into the engine and the clutch, and this is where the bolt head would be if it was installed on the BUV. Here's the new pump shaft. The older one, as you can see, there were some imperfections and it didn't run true. And like I said, the thread wouldn't go onto the new impeller. And here's the new one with the 3/4-inch straight shaft. And that worked with our new impeller on the new pump. So for powertrain accessibility, as Tom previously mentioned, basically the engine cage was just welded to the frame. You weren't able to remove it at all without having to cut the welds. You couldn't access anything like the transmission or the engine. You couldn't remove them very easily, if at all. So what we ended up doing was cutting off these welds and the cage with a sawzall, and we made some tabs for them to be welded to. And we drilled holes through the frame and used some grade 8 bolts. So now the frame is actually removable, and we're able to take it off whenever we want to get to the transmission or engine. Here's a picture of the previous design where it was welded straight to the frame. And here's what we ended up with. We have the mounting tab with the grade 8 bolts. And there's 4 mounting points. So we made 4 tabs and have 4 holes in the frame, and it's pretty easy to pull it off. Now the low gear actuation cable we had some trouble with. We couldn't get it into low gear every time, not reliably anyways. Complicated assembly and disassembly. There's a whole setup of springs and washers that didn't need to be there, and it just looked bad. The new cable retainer I made using a 1-inch nut, and that seated the cable in place for when you pulled on it. We used a simplistic design that only had 1 spring and 1 washer, and this design reliably engages every time. So here's the previous linkage. As you can see, there's 3 springs and like 4 or 5 washers, and it was just a nightmare to take apart and put back together. And like I mentioned, it wasn't reliable. And here's what we ended up with. We have the cable going into the 1-inch nut where it's seated. We have the washer here with 1 spring, and then we just have it fed through the existing lever and a bolt to make sure that that doesn't come out. And that works every time.
So another problem we had was the floorboard on the vehicle. The existing floorboard was made out of 1-inch deck boards, and there was some spacing in between each board, and that allowed debris to get in where the master cylinders for the brakes were, the wiring, and the throttle cable as well. So we figured, you know, and they weren't too secure, so we figured might as well make a new floorboard out of a single piece of 5/8 plywood. We fit it exactly over the top of the floor frame that is there, and it does end up protecting the brakes and master cylinders from mud flying. Obviously, this is a competition where we're in tons of mud. We got to protect them, and it's pretty easy accessible to remove only one board instead of each individual little planks there, and you can get to the throttle and get your brake system real easily. And this is just a picture of it. As you can see on the left, there's the deck boards laid down. Like I said, not really secure. Debris can easily go in. Now we have an entire plywood sheet covering the master cylinders and the throttle linkage, along with the wiring. And really simple, sturdy, keeps everything well protected. So our last improvement is our power maximization. After talking to Professor Martinelli, he was saying that the previous year students, they weren't running the engine at full rated speed. Possibly, you know, could have been done to a number of things. One thing we noticed was that the accelerator lacked the required travel. You know, lower idle also prevented the machine from moving, and we wanted to achieve full engine speed by increasing the travel. So we removed a section of the pedal stop that is found on the frame of the BUV, and that increased the travel. And we ran at rated RPM, high gear, and this provided more vehicle speed, obviously, and proper movement of the CVT. The CVT on the engine was able to close, and on the secondary on the transaxle was able to open up, and we were able to move along at a pretty good clip during competition.
So now I'm on to competition data. So these are some rates from our water pumps and our efficiency that was taken actually from our pump cycle times during the competition. So our loading time to fill the three 55-gallon drums in the back was 1 minute and 36 seconds over three cycles. And this works out to be 165 gallons in 1 minute, 36 seconds, which equals 103.125 gallons per minute. And the actual flow of 103.125 gallons per minute divided by the rated flow of 131 gallons per minute, which is a theoretical pump flow, gave us an efficiency of almost 80%. And for our offloading times, we averaged 1 minute and 42 seconds over three cycles. And when we look at the efficiency of that, that equals about 75% efficiency. So our average pump efficiency worked out to be over three quarters or 75%, which we thought was really well, especially when you consider theoretical and actual efficiencies in many systems. It's, if you can hit 80%, that's pretty well, and that's what we were able to almost do at competition.
Well, one of the main reasons why our efficiency isn't completely at 100 or above 90 where we'd like it to be is the whole transition from the inch and a half plumbing system to the 2-inch inlet and outlet on the water pump. If we went to a straight 2-inch system, we could probably achieve 90% efficiency.
And then our vehicle speed at competition was 2.2 miles, or it was a 2.2 mile all-terrain course. And we had 355-gallon drums in the back that were all full of water, and that equals out to be 1,378 pounds. Our fastest lap time was 27 minutes, and so if you divide the overall course distance by the time in our fastest lap, it equals 4.5 miles per hour. And our top speed estimate, just on little sections of the track, was about 15 miles per hour. And we were definitely the fastest vehicle at the competition, and that benefited us a lot, especially when we ran into a problem with our throttle cable. We ran into a problem on like the third lap. It broke, and we ended up wiring it up with a pair of vice grips, and it got us through the competition and helped us achieve first place. And as I led or gave you a little lead into, we did win the competition. As you can see right here on this slide, we have our trophy and the engraving puck that'll stay here at Alfred that says the 2018 BUV champions. The final standings were Alfred at the top. We had 395 points. Second place was University of St. Thomas, which is located in Minnesota, and they had 310 points. They had a really good design for their vehicle as well. They had a lot of hydraulic outputs for their pump and other components. And the only problem was they ran on a gas motor. I think if they use a diesel motor next year, they'll be able to have the required power that they need to run that system. And then in third place was University of Cincinnati at 295 points. But as you can see by the final point total, we had quite a big lead and won by quite a lot. The maximum points you could achieve per one lap was 55 points, and that was if you ran a lap with three full barrels in the back of your BUV. And this is a picture of the three of us after the win. We're obviously pretty excited and a little sunburnt after the 2 days out in the sun in Ohio, but we had a great competition and we were glad to take part in this. And here's some future improvements and recommendations that we have for the BUV participants. So we recommend that they incorporate a voltage inverter. The University of Cincinnati had this on their vehicle, and basically it allows anything to be plugged in that would require like a outlet. So I know that we actually use their vehicle to pump up our tires with an air compressor, and we're just thinking, we like some of our other points that we hit on, if we use like a hydraulic drive assist on the front wheel, which we think would help in the mud and just to get some grip, because sometimes the back two tires are our drive right now, and if those get stuck in a rut or something, just having that extra hydraulic push would help get it out. But then tying that back to the voltage inverter, an option to power that would be through the three-prong power supply. You could also power through the motor, but an easy way would be through the inverter. Same thing with the air compressor. We think that that would be a necessity to have a competition. The competition rules said that they were going to provide one for us, but we were able to end up borrowing the University of Cincinnati's air compressor. But the same thing, if that happened during competition, you want to be as fast as you can with all your improvements and implementations. So you don't want to rely on other teams because they're busy doing their own stuff, and you want to be able to use that stuff or use your tools as quickly as you can. So that would also require an inverter. We also recommend bringing a welder, and that's just if anything breaks, you can quickly weld it together, get it back together. Obviously, it's not going to be a permanent fix, but when you're at competition, you got to do what you got to do to make it work for the day. And as Tom talked about earlier, we want to make the whole water pump system have a 2-inch valve system, so we don't have any losses from the 1.5-inch to 2-inch adapters. This will increase the flow and decrease the time that it takes to load and unload the water. The pump drive tensioner, this was something that we ran into. Luckily, it was at the end of competition. It was our last load of the barrels. Our idler pulley that engages the pump sheared off, and due to some poor welding that was already existed on the BUV that we didn't catch. But anyway, that needs to be fixed next year to be able to engage the pump properly using the existing design. The next one is the throttle cable, which I talked about a little bit earlier. We did have a problem with our throttle cable, and it did break. It disattached from the foot pedal itself. On competition, I was actually driving the vehicle. It was on the third lap, and so we tried to rewire it, and after spending some time out there and falling a little bit behind, we decided that we just needed a quick fix, and so we used a pair of vice grips to wire it up, basically at full throttle all day. I mean, we could let off the vice grips and tether it when you're getting close to the pond, but it was kind of tricky, and it's obviously not going to pass safety next year using that design, but it got us through the day. Also, if you added a winch to the system, we think it would help. One, if you get stuck, you do get some support and you will get towed out, but it takes some time depending on how many vehicles are stuck or where you are on the track. A winch you can tie to a tree, which is available almost all around the course. to get yourself out. And also at competition this year, I ran into a problem on the first lap where a tree had fallen over from the night before when we ran the course as a trial run, and it blocked the path. So if I had a winch, I could have tied onto that and gotten that tree out of the way instead of being delayed and falling behind due to this casualty, really. Another improvement would be implement power steering. We did improve the front of the BUV, and it was a lot easier to steer in the mud. I thought it was really easy to handle. You guys agree?
Yep.
Yeah.
But sometimes when you went in reverse or you were in a rut with your front tire, sometimes the wheel would spin out on you, and it was kind of hard to get it back to the proper position. I know it took a lot of effort, and I think it would be a good implement to have power steering just to help with that, so you're not putting in so much effort. A big thing that would really help is a support vehicle. Some of the other schools had these, so if you break down or you have a problem and you're on the other side of the course, not in the stationary like center of the course, which is right by the pond, you have a support vehicle that can rush them out some tools and come see what's wrong and assess the situation, because when you break down, the only person that can assess it is the driver. And like I know when I had the problem with the throttle cable, luckily I knew that that was the problem, and I was able to call these guys and tell them that's what we needed, bring the tools, and they brought what we needed, but it was quite a hike.
And we had to run probably close to 3/4 of a mile across the field to get to them. If we had some UTV or something, we could have got there quicker, sped up the process, hopefully. So.
Yep. And luckily you brought the right tools the first time, because otherwise we could have really been delayed having to run back and forth and get the stuff that we needed. Then another thing would be an enclosed trailer. A lot of the other schools, the big university went up against, they had these. I mean, they almost looked like they were going to a NASCAR event. They had more tools in their trailer than we had accessible in the ice lab. But as it turned out, it didn't really matter. But we think eventually it would be a nice addition to this. And just inside the enclosed trailer, we would have some toolboxes with some parts that we would need, various fittings, and just things that we didn't think to bring, but we had some stuff, but we were running on like zip ties and some crescent wrenches and a few of the size wrenches that we knew we were gonna need. And other than that, another addition that would help would be some Gorilla Silverback tires. These things have monstrous treads. I don't think you'll have any problem in the mud. Our tires seem to hold up, really our vehicle as a whole did hold up, but when referencing back to like St. Thomas with their hydraulic system, in the coming years, I think they're really going to be a force to be reckoned with, and I think that in order for Alfred State to stay on top, they need to make these little modifications that are just going to keep our system, our design from the original BUV, just keep going strong and keep it up top. And lastly, but not least, is a big boy sponsorship, because when you get down to Ohio, Alfred State runs on big boy, and that is a big field of victory.
Best food ever.
Yep.
Okay, so here's the BUV in its state after the competition. Pretty sure most of the mud flew off on the ride home. Going back to the vice grip throttle cable situation, here we have that. Pull up a little extra to get some more throttle if we got into a sticky situation. And then over here we have the low gear cable holder. We have the solid floorboard, and coming back around, we have the new water pump. And you can see back in here, we also have the new PTO shaft right there, and that drives this shiv right there. And inside here is a gearbox, and I'm not sure if you can quite see it, but the pump shaft is spinning there. Everything comes off easily. These are just some nuts that are welded there that this bolts onto. Everything comes right off. Here's the 1.5-inch valving system here. This would all theoretically have to be changed over to 2-inch to get the maximum efficiency out of the pump. And then for us to unload, we just have to swap all of these valves around, and it's pretty easy. Here's a close-up of one of the mounting tabs, and here's another one. Other than that, as vehicle did really well with the modifications that we made. The only trouble we ran into was the throttle cable. Oh, and the star of the show, the new Yanmar diesel.
City boy, I'm Earl Dimples Jr. I'm a country boy. You're a long way from town to be running your mouth. See the smooth tires spinning like that? That's why we use nothing but mud tires, 4x4. You got your hair slicked back and your skinny jeans, collar popped up and your car's itty bitty. Better turn around and go back to the city.
Whoa, whoa.
You can pop that clutch, you can pop that collar. I'ma pop this top while I holler.
Whoa, whoa, whoa.
You can pop that clutch, you can pop that collar. I'ma pop this top while I hey. City boy stuff. Penny lovers didn't bring no love. Should I throw him a rope? No, hell no, not me. I'm rolling on by. Don't shoot the gun. Barbed wire tattoo. Don't even go all the way around.
Hee hee!